So thank you, Jan. It's a great honor for me to speak at this wonderful conference. And it's, of course, the perfect place for me to express my depth and gratitude to Maxime's ideas and influence. And when Maxime invented motivic integration almost 20 years ago, I'm not sure he really could anticipate how many developments there would be and the wide range of applications. So initially, I planned to present a general overview of many of these developments, but finally, I've chosen to focus on more specific recent results that combine the two different topics Maxime has contributed. So, as a side note, I have the privilege to share Maxime's birthday date. Of course, I'm not born the same year, but it's, so I know perfectly well which day he was born, and so I know when we left to wish him a happy birthday. Okay. So this is a joint work with Antoine Chamberlain. It's available as a preprint and archive. And the topic of the talk is an application of motivic integration to curve counting. This seems appropriate for talk in honor of Maxime because he contributed both topics. However, the approach I will present is, I think, kind of new. And I must say that I think it is a method I will present that is maybe more interesting than the final result we have. I mean, I'm not so sure the result I will present is really interesting for itself, but maybe the method is. Okay? So we will make a fundamental use of a result by Ruchowski and Kasdan, which is a so-called motivic Poisson formula. So a substantial part of the talk will consist in making sense of this formula, what it means, and then I will explain how it can be applied. So. Now, I just want to mention what Ruchowski and Kasdan did with that, even if it has nothing to do with anything of this talk. So if you don't understand what's written in this on this slide, I mean, it's not a problem at all. And so so they consider this following situation. So they start with a field of characteristic zero, and consider two different division algebras over the field of rational function on F, which are associated with two distinct elements of the same cyclic Galois group of prime order over the residue over F. And then you can compare data over D1 and data over D2. And so there is a notion of matching of integral conjugacy classes and of matching of local motivic test function, whatever this means. And what they wanted to prove is that if you start from local test functions that match, then the Fourier transform match. This is what they want to prove. And why do they want to prove that? It's because a long time ago, I mean, there was result by Delin, Kasdan, and Vinieras over the PADX. And they prove something similar. So it's an equality or a relation between periodic integrals, so local integrals. But it can only be proved at the time, and still now, by a global argument. So they needed use of the trace formula to prove this equality between local integrals.
Trace formula on the
other way. Yeah. And so, okay, there is a general philosophy that whenever you have identity between periodic integral, there should be a similar identity between the motivic ones. But this could be a possible counterexample because the proof of the identity being not purely local and motivic integration being apparently local, you could expect that this would provide a counterexample, but in fact, the result of Ruchowski-Kasdan says that it does not provide such a counterexample. Okay. Now, the results I will present are a function field analog of some results in arithmetic, so I will start by recalling these results. So these are about Manin's conjecture on the estimating the number of points of bounded height. So I think you all know what is a classical height. So you have a rational number and x ratio of a and b. Maybe b is non-zero. And so the height is just the maximum of the absolute values of both numbers. And so it's a measure of arithmetic complexity. So more generally, if you have a rational point in the projective space, then you can consider the height by taking the point in homogeneous coordinate and with coprime coefficients, and you take the maximum of the absolute values. The first basic result is due to Northcott. I mean, it says that if you fix B, then you have only finitely many points in the projective space with eight.
This is completely empty. You're saying you're
Yeah. Right. You're right. Thank you. I'm sorry for that. Yes. I'm sorry. Okay. What's less trivial is this: is that there is an estimate.
Now you're in queue.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay. And it's more or less obvious, yes.
No, it's equally obvious.
It's obvious, but it appears in the papers by these people. I'm sorry for that. No, maybe not the first one, I'm sure. But
the trouble is, you discover the people who have been written by somebody 100 years before.
Absolutely.
It's different terminology.
Yes, but it was.
Okay. No, but okay, most I think everyone in this room is able to prove this theorem.
The Gauss did prove it.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. And now I think maybe Don will be more happy. So we introduce a generating function. Okay. And so it's called the Hey Zeta function, and it encaptures the asymptotic behavior of the number of these numbers. Okay. We want to. So there's a general question by Manin. So okay, it's in a framework of number fields and or function fields over finite fields, and you can replace Pn by any projective variety. Consider polarized varieties, so some ample line bundle on a projective variety X. And the question is about understanding the asymptotic behavior of this counting function. So it should be of this form. And Manin's question is about understanding the exponent S, the exponent of B, and the T. I don't know what this looks like cross, but it should be a T of the logarithm. Of course, this and maybe also the C. So of course this is when you translate into this generating series, this can be reinterpreted in terms of the first pole and its order and so on by well-known Tauberian results. So you can ask about the abscissa of convergence of this function of S and about its possible neuromorphic continuation, and it's
probably in general, the answer is no, as follows from negative solution to the Hilbert problem. Now, the pathological example, when there is no
advantage. Yes and no. I mean, I will add the hypothesis, and So what Manin proposes is in a quite special setting. So taking as ample bundle the opposite of the canonical divisor. So you assuming so it's the Fano framework. He gets a conjecture for what could be S and T. Okay, so S should be 1 and T should be the rank of the Néron-Sévry group minus 1.
But this for non-singular, right?
Yeah.
For non-singular.
And Per refines this by being able to give a conjecture for the constant C as a kind of Tamagawa measure. Okay. So here one should be cautious to avoid trivial counterexamples. So okay, so as I said, when one assumes X is Fano quite often, when it's better to have that the rational points of X are Zariski dense, otherwise the geometry of these rational points is governed by some subvariety. So it has nothing to do with X. And sometimes it's also necessary to replace the ground field by a finite extension, and also to restrict the counting problem, because you could have strict subvarieties with too many points, and you should exclude these to recover something significant. So Manin, the question is really a question, it's not a conjecture. It's known in many cases. In some cases, so for hypersurface of small degree, so then it belongs really to analytical number theory. It uses the circle method, and one of the first cases known is that of flag varieties. So this uses a result by Langlands on Eisenstein series, and this is due to Franke, Manin, and Schinkel. Then there is a whole series of work dealing with equivalent compactification on some algebraic groups. So it started with Torrey, so the compactification of toric varieties. So this is work of Batyrev-Schinkel. Affine spaces, so this is Schamberg-Laurent-Schinkel, and generalized to simply connected semi-simple group by all these people, and so on. And still another last direction is that of Del Pezzo surfaces. And the list is continually growing. And there are also counterexamples, so it's not always true. So first counterexample is due to Batyrev-Schinkel. You take the total spaces of the universal family of diagonal cubic surfaces. This provides a counterexample. And you also have the Hilbert space of 2 points on P2 or P1 cross P1. Okay. But as of today, it seems that the power F predicted of S predicted by Manin always stands. I mean, there is not yet a counterexample to that. The counterexample are about the power of the logarithm and the constants. Okay, but okay. Now, what is the geometric version of this? So, this is a very classical dictionary. So, we start with a projective curve, non-singular field small k, and we consider its function field capital F. And so, the geometric situation will be that of geometry over the curve C. And so, rational point will correspond to a morphism from C to the projective space, or if you consider better the relative projective space, it will be a section of this mapping. And the height, or better the its logarithm version, so small h with position to capital H, is can be interpreted geometrically as a degree. Here you have the standard line model on Pn, and you take its pullback on the curve, and you consider its degree. This is a number which is a logarithmic height. Okay, so more generally, we will consider morphism from variety to C and try to count sections of degrees smaller than something. This is the ID. Okay. Then, in this setting, finiteness of points will become the fact that translate as the fact that if you consider a section of a given degree, they will be not be finite, but they will be form, or maybe better, be the rational points of some algebraic varieties over small k. So that's the idea. And now, Pair, in fact, was the first to suggest around 15 years ago that one should investigate the behavior of these varieties when d varies with d. So this is the idea of the. This is what I want to explain today. Okay. So we start from again with C of K, and we'll have. So curly X will be just a proper flat morphism. Okay, we take some line bundle, and when we restrict to the field of function, to the generic point of the curve, we put Roman letters instead of curly letters, and so we will assume that the Kodera dimension of L is maximum. And in fact. We will not count all sections, but we will, for technical reasons, we will have to add a condition of this type. So we will have to consider sections that belong to some appropriate subset U. So to guarantee that the set we want to compute really are constructible over the small field. For large negative degrees. So then we'll consider the geometric A zeta function, which is a generating function. Okay, and we will work in a framework when the number of negative terms is finite. Huh? So it's really a Laurent series. Okay. And we will view this as a formal Laurent series with coefficient in the Grothendieck of varieties K-var. So let me now explain what is this ring. So you all know, but in fact, since we will use Fourier transform, we will need to enlarge these classical rings to some larger one, which allow to perform Fourier transform.
So Grothendieck ring, we call this Machiavelli. Yeah, this is what we will say when it comes to Grothendieck ring.
Why is it called Machiavelli? So maybe you should ask the question to Maxime, because he is the one who said Machiavelli integration, who invented the terminology. He did not only invent the concept, but invent the terminology Machiavelli integration. But historically, I mean, I think there is a good reason to call them Machiavelli, because these ring k-var occur in the correspondence between Grothendieck and Serre. Yeah, of course. with the question of comparing them to actual motifs. And if I remember correctly, Grothendieck explained that this guy are being too complicated to understand. It may be better to consider motifs which are more linear. So this is explicitly in the correspondence between Grothendieck and Serre. Okay, but you're right that we won't see any actual motif in the strict sense. Okay, so the Grothendieck ring of varieties of a field K is just defined by considering the free abelian group on isomorphism classes of algebraic varieties of K, and you add this scissor relation. So whenever Y is closed in X, you ask that the class of X is the sum of the classes of Y and its complement, and you get also a ring structure by just taking the Cartesian product of K. So it's a huge ring, in fact. It's complicated. It's known that there are zero divisors. And usually, one does not work in this ring. One has to consider some localization of this ring. Okay, we will see the one we need later on. So there is a unit element, just the class of the point, and a very useful Lefschetz element, which is the class L of the affine line. And a trivial relation is can express the class of the projective space in terms of this. Okay. So that's for the Grothendieck ring of varieties. And so just as a warm-up, if we consider this Pn cross C, and this generating series of, we look at sections of degree D, then in fact this was anticipated by Misha Kapranov in a paper which I think is unfortunately not yet published. A long time ago, he provides almost everything that is needed, what was needed for Pair to show that this series is rational and that to determine its largest pole. So. And even the residue, so which can be interpreted as you take so this limit, you multiply by the denominator, and it converges in some completion, which is a completion that Maxim introduced when he introduced the motivic integration, in some completion of this localized group. So he gets the pole and the residue. And for as a corollary, you can get estimates for the dimension, asymptotic dimension of these spaces MD. So they grow very much like n plus 1D. So they have finite limit, the difference of the finite limit. And if you consider the number of irreducible components of MD of maximal dimension, you also get an estimate. So maybe just a few words to explain how you get this from the two previous statements. So you have many additive invariants of algebraic varieties. So one of them is so-called Hodge-Jolin polynomial, which is built up with Hodge numbers. And of course, you can recover the dimension of an algebraic variety from the Hodge-Jolin polynomial, and also the number of irreducible components of maximal dimension. So this can be read off from the Hodge-Jolin polynomial. And so by using the Hodge-Jolin polynomial, from knowing the order of the pole, the pole and its order, you are able to get these asymptotic results on dimension on number of components. So this is a basic idea. Now, what we will do is the following. We will consider an irreducible smooth projective curve over an algebraically closed field of characteristic zero. So it should be it could be C, complex numbers. And we fix a non-empty open subset of C, and we take a proper smooth variety over C, with a non-constant morphism to C, some line bundle on this curly X, and we fix also a Zariski open subset. And as before, we denote with Romans the corresponding objects on the generic fiber. And we make very strong assumptions. So our result is very, we deal with a very specific geometric situation which has some interest, but I don't claim it's very extremely interesting by itself. For instance, as I will explain at the end of the talk, it would be much more interesting to consider toric varieties instead of this. So we will consider equivariant compactifications of vector spaces. Okay. And so so we assume this open U is just the vector space of rank n, viewed as an additive group. So X should be a smooth equivariant compactification of this. And we assume that the complement has strict normal crossings. And we take as L the logarithm version of minus the canonical divisor, okay, which is something very natural in this context. Okay. And now we will consider moduli spaces of sections which are of degree D. And that send this C naught, which was a given open subset of C, into U. Okay. This means that we don't consider, in fact, a geometric analog of Manin's question. We don't deal with rational points, but more with integral points. Okay, because this is an integrality assumption. This condition. Okay. Now, just by some general results on equivalent compactifications of fine spaces, one can prove that the space MD exists at least as a constructible set. So it has a well-defined class in the Grothendieck ring. And that for very negative D, the MD is empty. So we are in the right framework to go on. So we consider the generating functions. But so now what localization we will work in is so we not only invert L, but we invert all classes LA minus 1 for when A is strictly positive. Or you could say, and so we have such a Laurent series. So the very smaller ring is just these Laurent polynomials. And we will consider intermediate rings, which essentially say that the largest pole so we have a variable t, but it should be viewed as L to the power minus s. Okay, and we are just saying that. So this M curly T just says that the largest pole is at real part of S1. And this one just says that you can slightly continue to the left. Okay. So it's formally, so you just consider the inverses of these polynomials, 1 minus L A T B, but so only for B larger or equal to A. So as I said, this corresponds to this condition, if I'm not wrong. And the smaller one is you impose the stronger condition that B is strictly larger than A. Okay, and so this allows to evaluate such series here at L minus 1, just by plugging. Okay, you can evaluate them. This is obvious. And so our main result is that under the assumptions I have given. So the series ZT is a rational series, but it belongs to M curly T, so the largest pole is at T equals L to the power minus 1. And so here we just multiply by something related to the largest pole, and the P here is in empty dagger, so I can evaluate it at L minus 1, and I have really an actual residue, so I get something which is effective and non-zero. So to speak, strictly positive. In fact, one can precisely compute this T, but I won't in this lecture. And now if we look at the geometric consequences one can get from this statement by using the Hodge-Jolin polynomial. So we get results on the asymptotic dimension of the behavior of the dimensions of the MDs, and also about their number of irreducible components. So there is this A here, which is a bit an artifact, but okay, one can see one cannot really avoid it. So for any integer smaller than A, either the dimension of MD is small o of D, either you have something, a similar behavior as in the case of projective spaces, so minus D, if you subtract D, you get a finite limit. And also the ratio of the logarithm of K of MD and log D converges to some integer in this interval. Okay? And the second one occurs at least one. So you get at least one P in this interval. For instance, if A is 1, which is the best possible situation, you have only one P and you get this 2. This statement. Okay. So these are the geometric consequences. And now this is based on the Poisson formula. So let me explain what the Poisson formula is. So the classical Poisson formula, you all know what it is about. So you take a smooth function which is sufficiently decreasing at infinity. Okay, this is the hat is missing. And if you take the sum of the values of f on the integral point, it's equal to the sum of the values of its Fourier transform. And more generally, if you have a locally compact abelian group, and it's Pontryagin dual G star, take any discrete compact subgroup, then if you consider matching R measures on G and its dual, then you get a similar statement. So here the sum is of the point in the discrete compact subgroup. And the sum on the dual side is just you model by gamma and you consider the dual, which is same as considering the orthogonal. Okay. And so, for instance, this works when the field small k is finite, because then you have all the local compactness you can want, and the field f of a rational function is discrete compact in the Hadamard group, so this works adequately. But of course, when small k is capital C, this does not work a priori. Okay. And so this is what now I want to explain, the Rousseau-Fick-Cajdan formula. So it's over a curve. Take for simplicity an algebraically closed field k, g is a genus, and so it goes as follows. So I don't claim it. For the moment, this has no meaning, but this is what I want to explain. So you take the sum of the value of a function at all points in Fn, and a similar sum for the Fourier transform, and they are equal modulo factor L to the power 1 minus Gn. G is the genus of the curve. And the hypothesis is that... Okay, but of course, this is not yet defined. It takes some time to define. So the space S is a space of so-called Motivic-Schwarz-Bruyer function on the Hadamard space. Here you get the Fourier transform, so this space should allow some Fourier transform. And the sum is also, even if it looks very finite, it should be an element of some Grothendieck ring. Okay? So now let me explain the Rousseau-Fick-Cajdan. So as Fourier transform is playing a role here, I should explain about varieties with how to deal with exponentials. So, so now it's a variation of the Grothendieck ring of varieties. So, instead of just considering classes of varieties, you further consider a function f, a given function f on X. Okay, any morphism f from X to the affine line. And so you consider similarly the scissor relations, but you have one additional formula. I should explain. So take x is the point, and then you get that a1 with the function identity should be 0, and this should be interpreted by expressing that. If psi is a non-trivial additive character of a finite field, then it's well known that if you add the values of psi on the affine line, you get zero. Okay, and so this is really the meaning of this additional relation. So what I found we introduced these rings with Kluckers, and they were also considered independently by Rushovsky and Kasdan. And I was really amazed by the fact that this simple relation is enough to develop a theory of integration with exponential. Okay, this was not obvious for me at all at the beginning, but okay, it's just this very simple natural relation is enough to do whatever you want. Okay, so so XF should be thought as something like the function exponential of f on x. So it's this explains the ring structure. So if you have f on x and g on y, on the product you get exponential of f plus g, which explains this. And now you still have it's still a ring. You have a unit element. And you have, in fact, an embedding of the classical one. So we can localize, and you have an embedding of the classical one to the exponential one by just taking the function 0 whose exponential is 1. OK? So that's the idea. Now we need to do everything relative. So instead of working over K, we work over some K scheme, S. And so everything works out relatively. And you have functoriality. And so if you have a morphism between two bases S and T, you can go from a function on T to a function on S just by pullback. So this amounts geometrically to Cartesian product. Or you can just integrate. So integrate, you have something over S, and you view it as being over T. So this looks very trivial, but this is what it amounts to integrating. Okay. So, for instance, if you view x over itself, of course there are much less isomorphism than if you view x over spec k. And okay, so this operation is, even if it looks completely trivial, it means something. And as I said, so an element of such a ring, it can be thought as a motivic function with exponentials. Okay, so I should speed up, maybe not as much as Don did, but so now take some work locally. So K is a reduced field, and we consider the field of Laurent series and the ring of formal series. And I want to deal with Schwarz-Bruyer functions. So Schwarz-Bruyer functions of the pair D's are just functions with compact support, and which are locally constant. So the picture here is the following. You have a large ball, and you have smaller balls. So here m and n are relative to the valuation radius of the balls. And so you want the function to be zero outside and to be constant on each ball. Of course, this amounts to having a function just in the set of small balls inside the big ball. And so, this set of balls is just can be just expressed as this quotient, which is, of course, just a set of rational points of the affine space. It's just saying how much digits you need to determine a small ball within a big ball. Okay, and so this was the good news is that this guy is an affine variety of finite type, and so the Schwarz-Bruyer function of level Mn will just be our functions on this space. What else? Okay. And now the game is, so we can evaluate the integrals. So there is some normalization procedure, just by taking a... so this is just going to the point, pi. And now, I don't have enough time, but okay, you can vary n on m, and if you have this picture in mind, everything, what you can do is transparent. And so you can, you have various arrows, and you can just define the Schwarz-Bruyer function as a double direct limits of these spaces of functions of level mn, okay? And you have a way to define integral which does not depend on the way you represent things. Okay. This is, okay, it is what it should be, okay? And now you can consider Fourier transforms because you have exponentials, okay? A way to do that is to fix a non-zero global differential and to take residues. This is a nice way to get a bilinear form. And so you get in this framework a Fourier transform, and you get a Fourier inversion. Okay. Now, we should globalize that. So this was purely local up to now. So we work over this curve C, F is function field, and we, for any rational point on the curve, we get a local field, localization. And we did the construction for given FV, but since they all are the same, we could consider also a finite product of this FV. So for a given finite set, we can consider Schwarz-Bruyer function not on one FV, but on the product of the FVs, okay? And you can do the same Fourier inversion and so on. And we can enlarge S, and we get an embedding just by, so to speak, adding to the new place the characteristic function of the ring of integers, of the valuation ring. And now we get a ring of global Schwarz-Bruyer functions, which are just defined by, which are just, in fact, non-trivial at a finite number of places. So this is enough for what we want to do. This is not conceptually satisfying because, for many applications, we need Schwarz-Bruyer functions that are non-trivial at all places. Okay, but since it's not obvious to consider infinite products algebraically.
Is it also feasible to make something depends on the pole also?
Things of that are considered by Ushovsky Kajdan, but the most general generality is still to keep something open, I think. But okay, but so this is a very baby case, but which is enough for what we want. We can do Fourier transform. We have Fourier inversion again. And now, to get a full Poisson formula, we still have to understand how to sum over the rational points. Okay? But, the key point is that F is bad as an object over the residue field, but it's an inductive limit of these spaces. So these are standard spaces, Riemann-Roch spaces. So for any, say, effective divisor D, you take LD. And F is the inductive limit of this LD, and this LD are, of course, finite dimensional K vector spaces. Now, given a global function phi, it may be represented by something like that. So you have some N and M depending on the place. And now, if you take, so you have your divisor D, so for any finite set, you can evaluate a function in LD at these places, and you can truncate, and you get morphine from LD to these spaces parametrizing balls. Okay? And so it's easy to check that when D is large enough, thing stabilizes and stabilizes, and so you can just say the sum of my function phi here on F, I just, for D large enough, take the pullback of, it's a function here, I take its pullback here on here and just take its push forward to the point, and this will define the sum. Okay. And now I can state the Rochefort cache down Poisson formula.
So when you say Riemann
Roch
space, it means just linear system?
Yeah. As k-vector spaces, yes. Just the space of a rational function whose divisor is larger than minus d. So now you can make sense of this formula, which is what they prove. And in fact, the formula is not trivial, but it only relies on Riemann-Roch and Ansert duality. So it's not trivial, but it's elementary. Okay, so in the last part of the talk, now I sketch the proof. Okay, so in the arithmetical proof, in the arithmetical case, our result is a geometric version of a result by Chamberlois and Schinkel in the arithmetic case. And the classical things they do, I mean, to count points of bounded 8, they first extend the 8 to a function on the Adelic space. This is the first step. And so in their case, I mean, GF is compact discrete in the Adelic space, so they will use a Poisson formula to get a new expression for the zeta function of the 8, in terms of Fourier transform. Okay? And the key is, so now the parameters here are the characters. And so a special role is played by the trivial character, which is y equals 0, which is the main contribution. So, and this is the key. So you have an infinite sum, but one point is given the main contribution, and the other points are give smaller contribution. So this is, here one is really doing some, it's really Fourier analysis, I mean. The use of Poisson formula allows to just to extract the main term in this series. Sorry. Okay, and so the main term is here, so, and one can compute everything almost explicitly. It's boils down to classical Iguza zeta function. And in particular, one can get a meomorphic continuation and the main pole. And then one has to consider the remaining y's. So in fact, everything is zero outside some lattice. You get a meomorphic continuation with less poles. And in fact, you can sum over the whole lattice except zero to get similar result. And this is enough to conclude. In fact, we can do exactly the same thing in the motivic framework. So it's easy to say. In fact, in practice, we could do it. And what is strange, it really requires some work to perform, even if at each step it looks rather easy. And so here, what can we do? So we localize the height as a sum of local intersection numbers. Our assumption of being integral is very important to only have to deal with a finite number of places. And this we have to make this to assume that, because our Poisson formula only deals with situations which are non-trivial only at a finite number of places. And now we can we express our zeta function, so it's a generating series, and we make the Fourier transform of this. And so the key is that, of course, only a finite number of places play a role. Okay, and we have to understand these Fourier transforms, which now are local. And very much as in the arithmetical case, for the trivial character, you just get something like a motivic Iguza zeta function, so you can understand it very classically. And for more general Y, you get some oscillating integrals, but they are not too hard to deal with. For instance, you get something analog to this kind of integral. And so you have to understand that this kind of integrals are smaller poles than if you have no exponential. under some assumption, and this is not hard in the PIDX, and it works also in the motivic case. For instance, you have to know things like, so if you integrate the exponential of 1 over x over an annulus of large order, then you get 0, and this is very much the same as global homomorphy of this integral. So what's funny is that Chamberlois and Schinkel, they really use some analytical arguments. So you have to bound certain things in some strips, to use majorations, complex analysis, and so on. And all these steps can be adapted via some maneuver to perform it in the motivic case. Okay, so as I said, so now the main term will be correspond to the trivial character, and the summation in fact can be restricted instead of a lattice to a finite dimensional vector space. And when the character varies in the lattice, we get rationality of individuals and estimates of the poles, which can be preserved on some at least constructible partition of V, which is very much enough for motivic integration. And this is the way we prove the statement. So I will finish with a few concluding remarks. So, of course, it would be very relevant to be able to extend the framework, so to consider to deal with actual infinite products, and in particular to get motivic Tamagawa numbers. So there are some hints about this already, but I think one could understand also these things better. Also to change the group, so for instance, to deal with tori, so this would understand motivically, would mean understanding motivically multiplicative characters. So there is a big difference between multiplicative characters and additive characters. So of a finite field, there is only one non-trivial additive character, so to speak, which allows you to identify the additive characters with the field itself. But as for multiplicative characters, it's very different. I mean, they are not all the same. And so it's not at all clear what would be a motivic version of multiplicative characters and what would be a genuine Mellin transform in this setting. And this is this issue is really what makes it too premature to consider the toric case. And okay, we can even try more general groups like Schinkel and some of his collaborators did. Okay, this is done.
Questions?
Yeah, actually some technical question. This is exponential motivic ring.
Yes.
Does it have kind of homomorphism kind of two critical values, C and C since values also one, which previously considered even like if you have exponential integral put a small parameter, you get critical values and vanishing cycles.
Ah, your question is how is it related to critical values? The answer is yes. So you can put the story, you can relate them with the motivic Milner fiber and so on, in the same way as in the classical case, the asymptotic behavior of exponential integrals are related to the local invariance of the singularity. So this, you can play the same game.
And also, one part about this multiplicative characters, one can also consider this things of GM is multiplicative convolution.
Yeah.
This is kind of pretty formal object, and in a sense, But in principle, I had several years ago this integrable system.
Yes.
And it's kind of formal pure materially in this geometric setting, and one got kind of strange commutative rings.
I would be delighted to discuss with you about this.
In fact, if you have a stationary phase, is what kind of invariance you get because you are working over C? It's a little bit mysterious. So the local Fourier transforms, if you look at normally you get some from that force. But here you are working over C.
Yeah, I mean, So I mean, this is okay. Here I presented a very quite special framework because I deal only with Schwarz-Bruyer functions, which are rather trivial functions. But if you deal in a more general setting, you can you have exponential integrals over C of t. And if you consider things like that, or maybe put to t, then you get all the information, all the complex information over the singularities. Yes, yeah. So this is very similar to Lomon's stationary phase. So, so this is really into the picture. Yes. Did I answer your question?
In some sense, it corresponds to the tame case.
Oh yeah, that's a problem. Yes.